Christian Audio presents God Our Anchor, Held Fast Through a Loved One's Addiction by Deborah Bailey. Narrated by Erin Bennett. Introduction. Fearing we might run aground on the rocks, they dropped four anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight to come. Acts chapter 27, verse 29. In Acts chapter 27, Paul and some other men encountered massive storms at sea which battered their ship. One night, Paul heard from an angel of God who said, "Do not give up." Paul knew they would probably shipwreck somewhere, but he also believed God would see them through to the end. Paul and these men did all they could do physically by throwing over four anchors, and then they did what they could do spiritually. They prayed, knowing their primary anchor was God. Anchors signify a major point in our lives as we battled the storm of a child addict. But to completely understand this point, you need to know the definition of the word anchor. An anchor is a heavy object attached to a rope or chain and used to moor a vessel to the sea bottom. It can also be a person or thing that provides stability or confidence in an otherwise uncertain situation. Oxford Dictionary. As sailors encounter storms at sea, so we encounter storms in our lives. Some will be worse than others. When the storms first rocked our boat, I was a 43-year-old happily married Christian mother of two beautiful children, a girl of 16 and a 12-year-old boy. I was in an enjoyable, fulfilling, and flexible job in the medical profession. It sounds like I had a perfect life and had my act together, doesn't it? But nothing was further from the truth. It was the calm before the storm. I made a beautiful picture because being a Christian means everything in life is perfect, right? At least that is how most of us pretend to act around others, especially when we are with our church family. As a person of faith, I had a hard time admitting to the church, family, and friends about nasty personal storms. I had to choose honesty rather than running from the truth and life God had blessed me with so graciously. Christians are never promised a perfect life here on earth. That is what we will find in heaven. In fact, that is how heaven is now. However, we are still on earth with severe, sorrow-proclaiming storms and trials. I have had many little life storms, but this storm, starting when life looked perfect, was one of the biggest trials of my existence. My daughter, who loved God and led others to God, was becoming a prodigal child. She was wasting away the gifts the Lord had given her. At 16, she was making choices that affected not only her, but everyone in her life. Her rebellion started off as regular teenage disrespect and disobedience, but she crossed the line, and the storm blew out of control in our family. Soon, drugs, alcohol, and complete fits of rage entered our home. Drug addiction is a terrible storm that rips apart everyone in its path. It is a monstrosity. It rocks and batters your child and the entire family. As a parent, you may often feel like you will sink and drown in the storm, but rest assured, you are safe when you keep your eyes on the Master. While I could write a fascinating book on our family life over the last few years, that is not what God has led me to do. Through my experiences, I have found no profound solutions for how parents can rescue their child from drug addiction. I have read many books, attended counseling, and met with various medical professionals for my child. Family and friends have given advice, and I have learned a lot from the godly counsel I received, but that is not what helped me most in this storm. The one who rescued me is God. I found my peace through anchoring myself in His Word, through prayer time with my precious healer, protector, and savior, and through constant worship. God whispered to me a little over 3 years ago that I should write a book about my experience to share with others going through a similar storm. In fact, God led me to write a book of devotions to help other parents have scripture in their hands to help them through parenting a wayward, drug-addicted child. prayer and knowledge of God's Word are powerful battle tools. Both tools elevate authority over our troubles and raise our trust and faith in God. I let God lead me, desiring to be only a vessel for His Word. Listeners can feel the emotions from my experiences during these times. Feelings and emotions can get the best of our soul and body until we are as strung out as our addict child. But through prayer and scripture, a parent can stand firm and grow in faith through the storm of addiction. My desire through these devotions is that you find peace, joy, and once again sense God's love and grace through your storm of parenting a drug-addicted child. My prayer is that you will become anchored by God's presence, His promises, and His Word. I pray that you will no longer allow the raging storm of drug addiction to toss you to and fro to the point where you cannot see God or feel His presence. And if you do not know Jesus as your Savior, I pray you will submit everything to Him and allow Jesus to carry you through this storm. Finally, I pray that if you are already a Christian, you will renew your trust in God and not permit this storm to become bigger than your God. As you begin this journey with me, I would like to share Ashlynn's story. Her story is important because it shines a light on the source of all battles with addiction. The fight is against sin, not your child. Satan is our enemy and the one who seeks to steal and destroy anyone in any way to prevent God's glory and power from being revealed in this world. He uses drugs and addiction as weapons of attack. As you hear Ashlynn's story, you can see how, even before we realized it, the devil had already been scheming in our lives to wreak havoc and pull us away from God. Ashlynn's story. Beautiful, blue-eyed Ashlynn Nicole Bailey was born April 21, 1995, to proud parents Mike and Deborah Bailey. She had to stay in the step-down unit after birth because she required medical treatment for pneumonia after aspiration during the delivery process. Ashlynn was tiny but a fighter and stayed strong during the healing process. She had to stay in the hospital for 7 days before we could bring her home. We all instantly fell in love with her, our first child and the first grandchild on both sides of our family. We had to be careful about allowing Ashlynn to be around people soon after her birth due to her having pneumonia, but as soon as she could attend church, we had her there. She was dedicated at about 8 months in our church's parent-baby dedication ceremony. Growing up in church, Ashlynn learned about God and became a Christian at an early age. She loved God, felt that everyone needed to go to heaven, and even led several of her friends to Christ. Ashlynn loved people, adventures, having fun, and celebrating life. She was fun-spirited and never wanted to miss out on anything. Ashlynn's main struggle as a toddler and young child was handling her anger. She was usually happy, but when she got upset, she was upset. She was nearly impossible to console once she reached this point and would have to just calm herself down in her room alone. I mention this because it is important later in her life story. Ashlynn loved school, but had a few misfortunate events early in life that created a personal wound to her soul. She was a tiny little girl, much smaller than most children her age, but not much different from how her mom was as a baby and child. During her first few days of public kindergarten, she was ridiculed for being short. Girls would not let her in their club because she was too small to be in school. She came home heartbroken, and so were her mom and dad. We parented her through this the best way we knew how, but unfortunately, she would continue to be labeled as short, tiny, and little, even throughout high school. From the age of about 7 years old, Ashlynn wanted to be a cheerleader. She took dance lessons and gymnastics to help prepare her and began working on her cheerleading skills when she was in the sixth grade. In seventh grade, Ashlynn tried out for middle school cheerleading and made it. She cried tears of joy when she found out. She could not believe it. As parents, we thought this would help bring her the confidence she needed to overcome the low self-esteem she developed over being so little. Ashlynn continued to cheer through her sophomore year in high school and was on a competitive cheer team as well during those middle school and high school years. During this time, she was still kidded about being little, but she learned different coping methods to handle what she was feeling inside. She built up a tough outer exterior, but on the inside, I think it still crushed her. Ashlynn loved cheering, and you could not keep her away from practice. Once she was in high school, she decided she might even like to pursue cheering in college. An excellent, sweet coach she had on the competitive team encouraged her with her size because most college cheerleaders needed to be small to be flyers. During Ashlynn's freshman year in high school, we saw noticeable changes in her behavior. Many of her friends changed. Her grades declined from all A's to A's, B's, and a C here or there, and her desire to cheer and attend practice decreased. As parents, we suspected possible drug use, but we could never find evidence. We prayed for God to reveal the truth to us, and He did in two ways. First, I, her mom, awakened from a deep sleep one night to the sound of God's voice saying, "Your child is doing drugs." Second, a few days following that, she was drug tested at school and came home upset she would fail. Initially, she told us that it was her first time trying weed. Later, we came to find out she had been experimenting previously as well. We believe she was trying marijuana to fit in with her friends. Ashlynn was trying to show others she was big enough. We think the marijuana made her feel euphoric and like she was in control. We believe it made her feel like she had no pain and no anger. That would just be the beginning. As much as we tried to stay on top of this situation as parents, things spiraled out of control. It was simply an awful, gut-wrenching experience. She quit cheerleading by the end of her sophomore year. By then, her grades were plummeting, and she and her friends were constantly in trouble. Some of her good friends were pushing away from her. Her anger and mood swings were beyond manageable. We received phone calls from the police, and she was arrested. Just one thing after another. She never graduated from high school because she went to rehab the last 2 months of her senior year. She did well in this rehab program, came home, and took the GED before attending college for a brief time. The demon of drug addiction struck again. Through counseling sessions at the first rehab, we learned that Ashlynn had a terrible misfortune happen to her during high school, and she never got over it. She used drugs to hide her pain and her self-hate. While she had tried most every kind of drug, heroin was the hook, line, and sinker, her drug of choice. It is a tough drug to rehab from, especially in a real addict's brain. Looking back at Ashlynn's life and personality, we believe she had addictive tendencies all along, and it took one time of the right drug for her to be hooked on it forever, with the constant craving of that first experience with heroin. We believe the devil used the drugs to devour Ashlynn because he knew she could be a great Christian warrior. She was a threat to him, and he went after her with a vengeance. As a family, we claimed the verse Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11 over her life and our life. "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for calamity, to give you a future and a hope." New American Standard Bible. We were going to hold on to God's word no matter what the devil was throwing at us. Over the course of several more years, Ashlynn was in and out of various rehabs. She would have brief moments of victory over her addiction. She even tried to start school again at a junior college. Ashlynn so wanted a better life for herself. She wanted to pursue a career that would help others, but addiction would eventually win. She thought she had ruined her life forever and could not seem to figure out how to start over. Ashlynn did not want to be an addict and would often state she wished she had never tried drugs. She prayed and prayed for the addiction to be taken away. She wanted to be healed instantly from the addiction. Ashlynn was under much prayer during these tumultuous years. God was reaching out to Ashlynn in many ways, but she could not see it because she believed the devil's lies. Ashlynn eventually fell into a dark place. We think she felt that her life was hopeless and that she would never be healed of the disease. We believe she felt God had given up on her, which was what the devil wanted her to believe. It's hard to see your child in this degree of despair without being pulled into the pit yourself. A parent's journey. As a parent, each of us has hopes and dreams for our child. We want the best for them and for them to seek the best out of life. We work hard to provide, teach, mentor, and love our child. Parenting is an incredible, exhausting full-time job. When something like drug addiction comes along, it crushes dreams, creates doubt in our parenting skills, causes us to develop feelings toward our child and those close to us we have never had before, and it can even cause us to question our faith. It causes us to question our God. Can you see how the devil is using drug addiction not only to destroy your child, but to destroy you as well? Having a child that is a drug addict will produce some crazy, out-of-control emotions, thoughts, and conflicts that affect not only you personally, but others as well. These emotions, thoughts, and conflicts will create an inner personal turmoil and sleeplessness. The truth is, you won't even know who you are anymore if you let these issues rule your life. Your relationship with your child and spouse will suffer. Your relationships with your other children, your parents, and even your friends can be negatively affected. You will feel misunderstood, desperate, and you will pine for your old life before your child used drugs. And, while you will be willing to do most anything to stop your child from doing drugs, you can even become an enabler, which isn't what your child needs. Before long, you will isolate yourself from others, and you may even separate yourself from God. Depression sets in, and apathy rules because you cannot see how things could possibly get any better. You may find yourself in a deep, dark pit and not know how to get out. If so, you have fallen for Satan's scheme. You have listened to his lies, and you believe them. Satan has you right where he wants you. You cannot help your child, you cannot help yourself, and life has become a mess. All you need is someone to understand, someone to change everything, someone to make things right again, someone to give you peace, strength, and redemption from the pain and sorrow. Jesus is the only person who can do all of this, and somehow you must cry out to him. You must lay down everything, including your child, at the foot of the cross, a complete surrender of all. Then you must seek him, praise him, and worship him, repenting for allowing the storm of drug addiction to become bigger than God. Turn your focus on Jesus alone. Jesus never left you. You were pulled astray by the devil's schemes and lies, and you have been trying to fix everything on your own. You must reach the end of yourself before being willing to reach out for help, just as the person addicted to drugs. Only then can Christ resurrect us from our lowest and messiest of places. As you listen through these devotions, scriptures, and prayers, seek God with all your heart. Ask him for his help, and you will find it. You will see your faith grow and watch God deliver you from the dark pit. You will become the parent your child battling addiction needs. God's work in this storm will be obvious to your child and everyone around you. You will be anchored in the midst of your storm. Part 1. Batten Down the Hatches. In a storm, sailors will prepare the ship for the surge to come, often referred to as battening down the hatches. As you look out and see the storm on the horizon, you must batten down critical areas. Follow me on a journey of preparation for this storm of addiction. Day 1. Marriage Shaking. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Mark chapter 10, verses 7 through 9, New International Version. I am no expert in parenting, nor an expert in marriage. The words I write are a result of spending time in prayer and studying God's Word, and based on the experiences I have gone through in my marriage dealing with a rebellious teen battling a drug addiction. I preface what I say with this. Marriage is complicated enough without other stresses added, such as illness, disease, family, children, and careers. While all marriages should rely on God first, sometimes outside counseling is needed, and my intentions are not to provide this book as a substitute for professional counseling, nor is my role that of a counselor. The purpose of including marriage as a topic in this book is to share the experiences I have had and to demonstrate how keeping your marriage a priority is crucial in parenting a child addicted to drugs. Each one of us is unique in personality, beliefs, and life experiences. When a person gets married, he or she brings that uniqueness into the marriage and is expected to merge with someone with differing personality traits. Our personalities, beliefs, and life experiences affect our thoughts and actions in parenting. These differences can be a source of conflict in marriage, but woe to the marriage impacted by a rebellious teen, let alone a drug addict in the midst. You better have God front and center, and the two of you better be acting and thinking like one. My daughter developed many rebellious habits outside of drug abuse. In attempts to cover up her addiction, she became an expert at the manipulation game, and her best strategy was using one parent against the other. She would use the expression, "You always take Dad's side," or, "You love my brother more than me." When she was told no by one parent, she would go to the other parent and try to get the answer she wanted. This caused several marriage battles. Resentment was being built on all sides. Thankfully, God does not intend our marriages to be run by our children. He intends for our marriages to be founded by Him and through Him. He expects our marriages to be based on His Word. The husband is the head of the household and the spiritual leader of the family. The wife is the husband's helper and devoted to seeking the best for her family. With God as the center of marriage, husband and wife become one entity. They should support each other, have each other's back, and love each other deeply. Children can never be placed above the sanctity of marriage. Marriage was a vow the two of you took before God. Children are a blessing from God for your marriage. When one of your children seeks to be rebellious, you must first go to God in prayer individually and then as a married couple. Decisions should only be made with God's input and based on His Word.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.